Thanks to at home for staying with us for the next hour. Whether or not former Republican Senator John Ensign is going to go to prison may ultimately turn on the question of how much he lied to his own dad. That is what it may come down to for the disgraced former senator from Nevada. John Ensign implicating his own parents in the cover-up and ethics scandal around his extramarital affair is one of the human factors that comes into the sharpest relief with the new details that have just emerged from the special counsel investigation into Mr. Ensign's actions. But Mr. Ensign implicating his own parents is also legally one of the most important aspects of this whole thing. Without going into every detail of it, the bottom line here is that when John Ensign paid his mistress $96,000 in what very much looked like hush money, he may have been breaking the law. If that was severance, if that was money he was paying to her as part of the process of firing her, that would be illegal. What John Ensign tried to say instead was that the $96,000 he paid her was just a present, a gift. It was a present from his mom and dad to his mistress. Yeah, and because he knew that would sound exactly as not credible as it sounds to you hearing it right now, John Ensign had to concoct a strange story to support it. He had his lawyer put out an official statement about it, saying the reason Senator Ensign's mom and dad were paying his mistress $96,000 was because they were always doing stuff like that. It was a pattern of generosity. They loved giving presents, like, say, $96,000 checks to John Ensign's mistress and her family. They did stuff like that all the time. See, it was just part of a pattern. Convincing people of that story, however far-fetched it may be, is sort of key to keeping John Ensign out of jail. My mom and dad, I can't stop them from giving $96,000 checks to my mistress. They're doing that constantly. As part of selling that story, John Ensign had his parents sign legal affidavits swearing that paying the mistress $96,000 was not uncommon. They had done stuff like that before. According to the affidavits, they had previously purchased an all-expense-paid trip to Hawaii for the mistress and her family. John Ensign's lawyer drew up those statements. Mr. Ensign had his parents sign them, and then those statements became part of the official investigation into the John Ensign ethics scandal. And what we now know is that John Ensign may have implicated his parents legally by having them sign their names to that. John Ensign's mom, who signed the affidavit, was not even consulted before it was drawn up and put in front of her. When investigators got John Ensign's father, stepfather, under oath and started asking him questions about the thing his son had had him sign, the dad denied all of it. He said, quote, "That's absolutely false. This payment for these things in Hawaii, that's absolutely false. We never paid for anything. No, none of that. Paid nothing." But remember, if this Hawaii story isn't true, if this wasn't the kind of present John Ensign's mom and dad were always giving to Senator Ensign's mistress, then John Ensign maybe goes to jail. I don't know where you go for putting your parents in a situation like that, but maybe he goes there too. Even though John Ensign resigned from the United States Senate, the reason the Ensign sex and ethics scandal is not over yet is in part because of this brutal evidence, which has now been handed over to the Federal Election Commission and the Justice Department. Because even if the Senate can't kick him out for something like this anymore, this is bad enough that he may end up going to jail for it. So the next big thing we are waiting for in this story is a decision about whether or not the Federal Election Commission or the Justice Department are going to pursue John Ensign on the basis of this new evidence. That is what we are waiting to hear next. But you want to know what else we are waiting to hear? There is still a senator who is still in the United States Senate who is up to his eyeballs in this scandal and who is not John Ensign. It is Dr. Tom Coburn, Republican senator from the great state of Oklahoma. We've known for a long time that Senator Coburn was all wrapped up in this sex and ethics scandal. But we now seem to have an answer to the question, or at least a potential answer, to why he has been so squirrely about this for so long, why he has changed his story so many times. What's in this new report suggests that the John Ensign scandal is not only more morally egregious than we had previously known. The extent of what's described as Senator Ensign's sexual harassment, for example, is way worse than we had known it before. But it could also involve more potential legal jeopardy than we had previously known. And that could explain why, during this entire affair, Senator Tom Coburn has been making so many utterly contradictory statements about it, implicating himself, unimplicating himself, denying it, undenying it, saying he won't talk about it, talking about it, as everybody else involved in this situation sees their lives burn down. If Tom Coburn is going to be the guy who has no consequences from this, who just stays in the U.S. Senate and keeps, you know, sponsoring family values legislation because he knows best about those matters, certainly better than you, then Tom Coburn coming clean about his role in the John Ensign sex and ethics scandal cover-up is probably the other next big thing that we are all waiting for. From the minute this scandal broke and it was clear that Senator Coburn was tied up in it somehow, he has been all over the map in terms of explaining his involvement. What we now know, what we learned this week, is that it was Senator Coburn who personally negotiated the amount for a settlement payout to the family of Senator Ensign's mistress, the Hamptons. From page 37 of the report, the Hamptons lawyer tried to get a ballpark estimate from Senator Coburn as to the amount he would be comfortable with. The lawyer proposed $8 million. Senator Coburn said that the figure was, quote, absolutely ridiculous. Mr. Hampton then came back with some figures and estimated $1.2 million for their home and another $1.6 million to get started somewhere new. Senator Coburn responded by stating that, quote, okay, that's what I had in mind and I think is fair. That is straight from the special counsel investigation. Senator Coburn personally negotiating a financial settlement to keep the affair under wraps. But when he was asked back in July 2009 if he had done anything like that, asked if he'd had any kind of negotiating role in this scandal, Senator Coburn denied it. He said, quote, I never made any assessment of paying anybody anything. Those are untruths. Those are absolute untruths. After the scandal broke wide open, Doug Hampton told Nevada reporter John Ralston that Tom Coburn had played an intermediary role in trying to come up with a settlement for the family. Tom Coburn had tried to work out a settlement for the Hampton family to essentially bring the affair to a close quietly by keeping them happy. After Doug Hampton said that, Senator Coburn told Roll Call newspaper, quote, I categorically deny everything he said. We now have the details, though, that Tom Coburn had multiple phone calls with Doug Hampton's lawyer. In addition to haggling for an overall lower payout amount to the Hamptons, quote, Senator Coburn then stated that the Ensigns should buy the Hamptons' home because it is so close to the Ensigns, and the Hamptons should receive an amount of money above and beyond that to start over. Despite having played that negotiating role in the cover-up of the affair, here's what Tom Coburn told ABC's George Stephanopoulos about it.
There was no negotiation. There was, I'll pass it along, or yes, I won't.
There was no negotiation. In keeping with Senator Coburn's ostentatious self-declared piety, which has always been his political brand, how religious and upstandingly ethical he is, Tom Coburn told reporters after the scandal broke, quote, I was counseling Senator Ensign as a physician and as an ordained deacon. That is privileged communication that I will never reveal to anybody, not to the Ethics Committee, not to a court of law, not to anybody. Mr. Coburn apparently providing mistress payoff haggling services in his capacity as a deacon. In his capacity as a physician, Tom Coburn, I guess, providing obstetrical and gynecological advice to John Ensign, since that's his specialty, bravely refusing to disclose any of those conversations because of his religious and professional obligations. He would not disclose any of those things to anyone, not to a court of law, not to the Ethics Committee, not to anybody. What we now know is that shortly after saying that, Tom Coburn did start secretly cooperating with FBI agents, turning over thousands of pages of documents to federal prosecutors and sitting for interviews with the Justice Department and the Senate Ethics Committee, which, of course, he said he would never do. There's one thing that is still unresolved, though. According to the special counsel, as part of Senator Coburn's role as mistress payout negotiator, the senator personally called John Ensign's dad at one point to try to get the senior Mr. Ensign involved in the process of covering up the affair, or at least ending it. One witness gives sworn testimony that this phone call happened. Senator Ensign's dad says he doesn't necessarily remember, but he acknowledges it may have happened. As for Mr. Coburn, he absolutely denies it. Given everything else that Tom Coburn has explained already about his involvement in this scandal, do you believe him? Joining us now is Melanie Sloan, Executive Director of Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington. Her group's complaint to the Ethics Committee about Senator Ensign led to the special counsel report released yesterday. Crewe also has filed a separate complaint to the Ethics Committee about Senator Coburn's involvement in the scandal. Melanie Sloan, thanks very much for being here.
Oh, nice to be with you.
Why did your organization file the complaint about Senator Coburn specifically? What potential rules violations or criminal violations are you do you think should be considered in terms of Senator Coburn?
Well, at the time, Mr. Coburn had been changing his story dramatically, and as we can see, he's changed it even through today. But in addition to the constantly changing story, which didn't reflect creditably on the Senate, there was also a question about whether he conspired with Doug Hampton to help Doug Hampton violate the lobbying ban. There was some evidence that, including Mr. Coburn's own words to the New York Times, that Mr. Hampton brought in the head of Allegiant Air, a Nevada company, to come and see Mr. Coburn. And Senator Coburn, just like Mr. Hampton and Mr. Ensign, was well aware that the Senate lobbying restrictions would have forbidden that. And so he, too, may have aided and abetted Mr. Hampton in violating the lobbying ban. Listening to you go through all of that, you know, what strikes me is that it seems quite possible that the Justice Department gave Senator Coburn immunity. In the special counsel's report, it says that John Lopez got immunity and that other people did as well. And Senator Coburn, who clearly had some legal liability issues here, may well have been another person to get immunity in order to tell everything he knew and to provide all these documents to the FBI.
Is that the sort of thing that somebody would have to own up to if they were asked, or is that the sort of thing that the Justice Department or the Ethics Committee or Senator Coburn himself could reasonably keep secret if he had immunity?
Well, I think whether he could keep it secret and whether he should are obviously two separate questions. I think Senator Coburn owes the American people an explanation of his full role in this scandal to answer questions about all of it. And if he indeed got immunity from the Department of Justice, I think he should share that. It was clear from the special counsel's report that the special counsel did not believe Senator Coburn about whether or not he'd called Michael Ensign, Senator Ensign's father, because Michael Ensign then contacts John Ensign, and John Ensign calls Tim Coe, his spiritual advisor, are furious that his father has been contacted. And Tim Coe was quite certain that the person who contacted Senator Ensign's father was, in fact, Senator Coburn. So given all this circumstance, I think it is incumbent upon Senator Coburn, who is still a sitting senator, by the way, to lay out exactly what he did in this case.
What is the status of the complaint? Have you heard anything back from the Ethics Committee about your complaint about Senator Coburn in particular?
No, we haven't heard anything. It is referenced in the special counsel's report, but I imagine that this was because it was a report about Senator Ensign. They didn't address that. But it seems incumbent upon the Senate Ethics Committee to advise us of its findings related to Tom Coburn so we can know all the facts in this case.
As I mentioned in the introduction, that the Ensign investigation has been turned over both to the Justice Department and the Federal Election Commission. How confident are you that either of those agencies will proceed against Senator Ensign now, given this additional evidence that was put forth in the special counsel report?
Well, Rachel, as I'm sure you know, the FEC is an entirely dysfunctional agency, and so no one should ever be waiting for the FEC to do anything, no matter how egregious the situation before it. The Justice Department has also previously passed on the Ensign matter, and they would have had an awful lot of the evidence that was in this special counsel's report already. So you have to wonder if they'll reconsider. The new facts for them might be the obstruction of justice, that Senator Ensign was, in fact, destroying evidence and emails in order to avoid having all of the situation come to light. So that could cause some additional charges. Also, as you mentioned, there could be charges not only against Senator Ensign, but against Michael and Sharon Ensign for the false affidavits to the FEC. So it's possible they'll reopen it. But really, the Justice Department hasn't been particularly aggressive with going after high-level political officials ever since they bungled the Ted Stevens prosecution.
Melanie, can I just ask you about one other former senator who turns up in the special counsel report? He's now a presidential hopeful once again. He's a former senator. It's Rick Santorum. He turns up in the report, I believe it's page 42, because I've been reading it over and over and over again, as the man who tipped off Senator Ensign that the Hampton family might be ready to bring the affair to public attention, thus giving Senator Ensign the chance to get out ahead of the story and announce it himself. Does Rick Santorum have any potential liability or things that he should further explain, in your view, about his role in this scandal?
He absolutely owes us an explanation. Senator Santorum received an email from Doug Hampton, a desperate email when Doug Hampton was trying to sort his way out of this mess. And Doug Hampton sent Senator Santorum an email explaining the whole thing and asking for his help. And what did Senator Santorum do with that information? He just passed it along to Senator Ensign and then shut up about it. And this is another guy who, like Tom Coburn, is constantly preaching how he is of a higher morality. He's better than the rest of us. And here he is covering up for a fellow senator, a fellow family value senator, and hiding the most sordid kind of affair. You can't imagine that he would have done the same thing, say, had he learned such facts about a Democratic senator.
Melanie Sloan, Executive Director of Citizens for Responsibility and Ethics in Washington. I have a feeling that we'll be talking to you about this again as this continues to unfold. Melanie, thanks very much.
Thanks.
We are finding out so much about our nation's declared enemies since Osama bin Laden's death. For instance, we learned a lot today about